This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Prologue. Reading and Writing Spiritual Utility. Via. A poet is the most unpoetical of anything because he has no identity. He is continually informing and filling some other body. One way through that has been mine. Expelled from the stability of water, first home, the negative seeker becomes aware of annihilation as a physical fact nature promises, making room for the next physical fact. Now the relation of human nature is this. Human nature does not know this. Human nature cannot know this. Human nature does not know that if everyone did not die, there would be no room for those who live now. In relation, I shall say I and mean you, who shall walk with me here, intent in approaching momentary grace in each precipitous ending. In the space between I and you, we shall find ecstasy. When I am in the room with people, if I ever am free from speculating on creations of my own brain, then not myself goes home to myself, but the little time annihilated. An etymology charts a line, and the lineage sought is ecstasy, from Old French ecstasy, via Latin via Greek ecstasis, standing outside oneself. An etymology is a physics, and the evolution scene is one of annihilation, from the Latin annihilo to reduce to nothing, a dialectic in particle physics between elementary particles and antiparticles that release an other energy. In annihilation is ethos, a nature. Intelligences are atoms of perceptions, in short they are God. Three grand materials, the intelligence, the human heart and the world of elemental space suited for the proper action of mind and heart, for the purposes of forming the soul or intelligence destined to possess the sense of identity. The identity, which in the making is forever shedding. If you are ready to leave father and mother, and brother, sister, and wife, and child, and friends, and never see them again. If you have paid your debts and made your will and settled your affairs and are free, then you are ready to walk. To better love them, to perceive, to apprehend for the first time, without the names with which you thought to contain them. The stars, the suns of all visible other, and nothing I embody looking up. I is an ignorant and blessed composite of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, Eve, and Cordelia. The twins have set for the night, but the spoon and the hunter, the lantern's fire, son, daughter, and husband's love waxing. Which element constitutes the familiar dread, tight band around my chest, which its release in morning light now my hand pressed to my mouth? Moon waxing, sky a time water, cars outside one brief whine after another. Light on the table now, raised the shade. My anguished friends John and Simone, their book spines up, a pale, dying boy, starving factory angel at the flywheel. Thoreau's fearless residence, sister dead, brother dead, his own lungs drowning as he crowed. Ecstatic Gertrude staring at the American flag in France, reinventing English one word at a time. A first bird's quick flit. I know the end is not available through synthesis, though each moment tends there without arriving. All event if you look and listen long enough, sentinel dog barks announcing. Night for hours long, and you did not apprehend it. Not for one second as your body lived, tended toward light, morning. What did you think to find before your family drifted in for tea? It is possible for us to be mediators between God and the part of creation which has confided us. Way. I want to say a word for via negativa, the negative way, a way seen variously, leading our pilgrim to ecstasy, and to an essential outside where self is, if not transcended, at least perhaps a bit closer to the promise of soul's speech. The traditional theological practice of via negativa entailed a radical denial of all definitions in order that the person pursuing this way could be united with the ultimate real, the word God itself a false promontory on this path dedicated to approach. A concept that crosses all boundaries, the term was described by Dionysus the Areopagite, by Meister Eckhart, and lives in the figure of the Bodhisattva central to Mahayana Buddhism. The Bodhisattva, Guanyin in China, who changed sex to become the female protector of women and children, to name only one historical figure, Did You Send Me Lucy, were enlightened beings that refused to enter nirvana in order to remain in the world for the sake of others. The Bodhisattva is capable of transferring his, her supreme state of being to others, and this action can be undertaken in any context, monastic or secular. To be a Bodhisattva is to engage a dialectic of energy, then, which is forever in exchange so long as there are those willing to pursue the way. Where entry means arrival, the negative way is lost. Bodhisattva cannot know she is Bodhisattva. The negative seeker wishes to describe a balance in order between peoples, their societies, the physical space each inhabits, and the actual real, which is both in and outside that space when one is openly seeking. I have approached that space in reading, in the letters of John Keats, in the word rooms that constitute Gertrude Stein's oeuvre, in Thoreau's Walking, in Simone Weil's essays we know now as Gravity and Grace, in countless texts, some of which I walk through in these pages. The writing I love most demonstrates a commitment to social and spiritual indeterminacy, and produces an activist energy that is transferred across to any reader willing to hear. Martin Luther King Jr.'s devotion to the beloved community demanded an active-passive resistance to laws that were derived from a world status quo, instead of the demos promised by Droits des Hommes. And as his literary confreres lived lives and created texts whose compositions relied on approach, King's emphasis was on a process of becoming that would convince by its engendering energy alone. The phrase passive resistance often gives the false impression that this is a sort of do-nothing method, in which the resistor quietly and passively accepts evil. But nothing is further from the truth. It is not passive non-resistance to evil, it is active non-violent resistance to evil. Selma. Montgomery. Ferguson. Baltimore. Everywhere. By the wayside. On the way. Samaritan's way. Poor wayfaring stranger. Have you lost your way? This is not a game. Very few have ever arrived at complete disinterestedness of mind. Very few have been influenced by a pure desire of the benefit of others, yet this feeling ought to be carried to its highest pitch, as there is no fear of its ever injuring society. Approach the word the world where she has never been equal. The page the door, to the diner the bus, where neither he nor she was allowed to sit. Lift the pen the cup. Raise a sound. Raised us all. When the coffee streamed down our face. I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you. Inhabit your words as you inhabit your body. Put it in, on, the line. Stop being somebody. Etymology of exist is the same as ecstasy. We are outside. We exist, we rid ourselves of I. We exist, we rid ourselves of you. The sun in sun, the deep hole in mine. Living there. 1.1. Ecstatic Émigré. 1. Preliminaries. 1. To experience time passing, and to know the sensation is the truth and province of poetry. 2. To feel the onus of this knowledge as a physical law. 3. A physical law and a dynamic that winds the experiencing subject into a circuitry, me and you us in them, then and now, citizen in state, nation in world, heaven in hell. 4. To become a traveler, a willing emigre in service of that circuitry, to write the poem that is each time and oftener the newest expression of that dynamic, which is universal love. 5. To falter moment to moment in the ever-emerging history of the present, which is not engaged in the language of ecstasy but of set territories as on a map. 6. To gain equilibrium again in sincere relation to contiguity and to the contingent, which house the actual human condition. 7. To mercy, pity, peace, and love. 8. To ecstasy, to the émigré in that order. The Ecstasy, 1382, Definition 2 from Existani, to displace, also drive out of one's mind, Existani Frenen. B. Émigré, the noun form, Definition 2, an emigrant, one who departs their native land to become an immigrant in another. C. To émigré, the verb form lost in English from the French past participle of émigrer, to have left. 9. To the displacement of mind for the next, to be driven from my mind. 10. To and in English, my language, and the emigration possible there. 2. Apology. A dying animal, I lean to sounds that hum the work of the world, as Allen Ginsberg writes at the end of Memory Gardens. Well, while I'm here all, do the work. And what's the work? To ease the pain of living. Everything else, drunken dumb show. And since I want to be alive until I'm dead, I listen for sounds that, in Spinoza's terms, are identical with that part of my nature that orients me toward the world. Louis Zukofsky expresses it sweetly in response to L.S. Dembo's question in an interview conducted in 1969. Q. Where does the idea of love fit in? A. Well, it's like my horses. If you're good enough to run, or you feel like running, you run. If you want to live, you love. If you don't want to live, you hate, that's all. It's as simple as that. Zukofsky's work is filled with horses, Homer's epic horses, Ovid's Lenti, Lenti Noctis Equi, Richard III's A Horse. A horse, my kingdom for a horse, saw horses in Brooklyn during the Depression, horses, after all, made of words and, most overtly, poems in the sound of a man and horse running madly, for dear life. For dear life, I hold much reverence, dear life, so full of things that constitute the reality of the temporal, that I am someone, and you another one, and trees and the sky and billboards and the news of the international financial crisis daily on the radio. In dear life, where we are all in time together, Baruch Spinoza's natura naturans, all things, more or less, more and less whole, by how fully what we are is moved by an orientation toward, and not away from the world, that uber thing. This belief in material, this thinking through things, contra-thinking beyond the thing, objectivism the things and not the movement, the things and a stance toward them, contra-symbolism, the things and a movement and a stance away or beyond this world. John Cage. Q. Why is this so necessary that sounds should be just sounds? A. There are many ways of saying why. 1. In order that each sound may become the Buddha. If that's too oriental an expression, take the Christian Gnostic statement. Split the stick and there is Jesus. Cage is speaking here of contemporary music, though he was also a poet and essayist, all of his work sui generis, aiming toward divinity. Dear life, the paradise in dear life. Thus also poetry and poetry that calls for, in the most literal sense, a radical calling into question of art qua art, thus poetry that is the fact, not artifact, of attention in time, and so is poetry turned toward the temporal. Cage believed that the infinite was available in art, and that the infinite was a mobile, fluid thing available in moments. In Meridian, a speech written in acceptance of the George Buckner Prize in 1958, Paul Celan defined this same attention to temporality as one paid by the poet of the creature. In the same speech, he poses questions about poetic reception, no doubt anticipating poems to come, and poems that would trace his contemporaneity through each moment's origin. May we, as happens in many places nowadays, proceed from art as from something given and implicitly assured, should we, to put it blankly, let's say, be thinking Mallarmé through to the end. Already underway with a radical dismantling of German in service of what he called the ever yet of poetry, found only by someone who does not forget that he speaks from his very being, his creatureliness, Celan would continue until his death in 1970 to emigrate far away from the lyricism of the celebrated poem Todesfugue that had established his reputation. Black milk of daybreak, we drink it at evening. We drink it at midday and morning, we drink it at night. We drink and we drink it. We shovel a grave in the air where you won't lie too cramped. A man lives in the house, he plays with his vipers. He writes when it grows dark too. Deutschland, your golden hair. Margareta. There are many who believe that poetry's purpose is to console, to make understandable our failings, our suffering and transient condition on earth. The same many, however, don't usually accept that language too is transient and must change to fit the condition of its use. Celan knew this. Having lost his mother and father, his origin to the death camps, he knew that there would be no consolation and that the acceptance of his beautiful Todesfugue was literary culture's desire to make comprehensible the murder of millions of people. Inconsolably, Celan's poetic practice evolved from a deep need to find, in language, an objective place to stand. Art creates a distantness. Art in a certain direction demands a certain distance, a certain path. But I think, and now this thought can hardly surprise you, I think a hope of poems has always been to speak in just this way in the cause of the strange. No, I can't use this word anymore. In just this way to speak in the cause of an other, who knows, perhaps in the cause of a holy other. Strange. No, I can't use this word anymore. Emphasis mine. No, indeed. In order to write the poems he hoped to write, Celan had to embrace his stranger to discover that his stranger was in fact a holy other who would demand a further language. In order to write the poems that would always speak in the cause of another, he and his language must, as he wrote in a late poem, Undebicum. The radical nature of his poetic enterprise would involve a via negativa that would travel by way of neologism, by way of anagram, by compounding, and by way of poems whose sense is available in the sound they make in time. Spasms, I love you, Psalms. The feeling walls deep in the U ravine. Rejoice, seed painted one. Eternal, de eternalized are you eternalized. You. Hey. Into you. I sing the bone rod scratch. Redred, far behind the pubic hair. Harped in the caves. Outside, all around. The unending none whatsoever canon. You throw me the nine times. Twined, dropping. I tooth wreath. A poem can be a settlement that lures the settlers into a false sense of security, even while the original inhabitants prepare war. Deeply unsettling, this late poem from Threadson sounds the late 20th century spiritual anguish of the survivor committed to diaspora. The Psalms turn spasms, the estranged I reaches a you that is both in and outside of him, reaches an eternity, which is also un- and de-eternalized, unlike the unending none whatsoever canon of established letters. Deeply unaccommodated, our emigre is nonetheless turned toward the world in his approach, waiting for what you will throw, waiting for the word that comes next. A concrete memoir. 1. Thousands of colossal houses stand shoulder to shoulder, many empty and only an arm's length from each other. For sale signs punctuate the front yards. Hummers and SUVs abound. The soccer mom, immortalized by Sarah Palin's lipstick joke, drives a scarab perched on her ear. In May 2011 in Las Vegas, one in every 57 homes was in foreclosure, topped only by Detroit. a hallucinatory American playground visited by millions each month, Las Vegas holds the record for the most cement structures in the world. In February of last year, in New York for a reading at Fordham University, at Lincoln Center, I shared a cab with a woman who researches environmental impacts for the government. She remarked that every building decision made in Las Vegas and environs has been categorically wrong for a desert region. From the construction of Hoover Dam, which made it possible for large populations to move here, to the 3,500-square-foot homes proliferating on 1/8 of an acre, 20 to a parcel, to the mega-resorts powered by the Colorado River and water bought from farmers in Arizona, Las Vegas is a spectacle of a living, physical crisis, accompanied by the social crisis such unplanned growth assures. In the bastion of the gated community, the city's former elite is now experiencing the same reduced social circumstances as their ungated neighbors. The realities of upside-down mortgages bring an equanimity to financial collapse. As reported in the local newspaper, tow trucks have taken to crashing through the gates of these communities in order to repossess cars for which people can no longer pay. Thus, in crisis, economics and social order go hand in hand. The foreclosed homes of the rich are now rented by several generations of illegal immigrants who pay cash. In this crisis is a sweet reckoning. If we are not yet forced to see the essential truth of our unaccommodated state, it's because we're driven by memory, which provides an a priori, a pre-approved image or comparison or loan, a transfer, metaphor, of value from previous epochs to our present state, which blinds us to the moment's prescience. Much has been written about the function of memory in poetry, with nods to the ethics of remembering as a socially redemptive force. This seems to me an essentially reductive sentiment, rooted as it is in the tired and historically unproved notion that if we don't know history, we are doomed to repeat it. Often, cultural memory causes history to repeat itself. If I look to Las Vegas as a receptor of this impulse, I'm forced to see that there is really not one structure, most especially not Hoover Dam, which is touted for its engineering, and the bodies of the dead who fell building it, which is of any actual value to the place it is. Las Vegas is the ultimate bod of the imagination of whom William Carlos Williams wrote into Elsie, in Spring and All, and proof of the falsity of Wallace Stevens's line, "Money is a kind of poetry." Las Vegas is our pyramids, built on the backs of the poor who flocked here in droves to share in Pharaoh's legacy, without ever a hope of sharing it at all. I'm on record as an apologist, even as a fan of the place, and with Walt Whitman, I'm glad to contradict myself. Still, if this place is worth anything, it is as a presentation, not a reflection, of the American self, the desire for an unaccountable self. There are things we live among, and to see them is to know ourselves. George Oppen, the objectivist, the critic of New York and California conversely, was our uniquely pastoral poet, though unlike Virgil, he could only write once he had returned home. Las Vegas is also our humanism, our short-sighted humanism, the demos without regard for the earth. I look to the desert for instruction, the instruction provided by Thanatos. Historical testing ground for America's nuclear proliferation. Nevada was declared a natural disaster area by the U.S. Department of Agriculture because of losses caused by drought over the past year. We live on the fossils of fish. I've seen them engraved in the rocks. I should like, with Whitman, to sleep with the animals and believe, with the late theologian Alan Watts, that it is high time to go back, or onto animism, and to cultivate good manners towards all sentient beings, including vegetables, and even lakes and mountains, emphasis added, and deserts. Provoked by the lineage of poetry that looks to the truth in things, I've seen, from time to time, the metaphysics of the physical. Oppen. And we saw the seed. The minuscule sequoia seed. In the museum by the tremendous slab. Of the tree, and imagined the seed. In soil and the growth quickened. so that we saw the seed reach out, forcing. Earth threw itself into bark, wood, the green. Needles of a redwood, until the tree stood in the room without soil. How much of the earth's crust has lived? The seed's violence. The shock is metaphysical. What comes after a desert? More desert. I live there. 2. The Mojave Desert will still be here long after Las Vegas is gone. A stretch of land that exists on less than 4 inches of rain a year. The Mojave supports 2,100 species of plants that survive by storing water. The desert's aridity, high temperatures, and low air pressure draw in moisture from the Gulf of Mexico in the summer months when the North American monsoon creates thunderstorms as far away as California's Central Valley. Wind is constant and fierce. This extreme place, named after long-vanished meadows, has taught me something about the truth of dispossession, and the books I've written chart an exilic path, one committed to soul sense above all. Accompanied by texts secular and spiritual, I've worked a process of duration and erasure akin to the physical life of the desert I see around me. It's remarkable and darkly hilarious how minuscule the Las Vegas Strip looks from 14 miles out of the city, on Junction 160 and the Rosary Pass. The neon and hotel lasers protest too much, their fluorescence unable to penetrate the night sky at 1,400 feet, though if you stood on the Las Vegas Strip on any night of the year, you'd be tempted to think there was no sky at all. Since I've lived in the desert, I've written to objectify the first person in the poem, looking for a linguistic origin that was lost in conventional grammar use. Repetition is the essence of music and of time, and in time, repetitions alter. Working also a notion of generation learned from William Blake, albeit in the fin de siècle of the 20th century and the first decades of the 21st, I have attempted to write poetry of phenomena, parts of speech interchangeable, durations replacing measure. In such a marriage as nuptial, possession is not possible nor desired, but in the transit I, no longer an altar, reaches her others, engaging a body electric. The poem proliferates subjects. I, while not an altar, is a bride, which grows and with the seeds of the tree is the kitchen unravished bride of pure art, never completed but alive through perpetual remaking of origins. Having achieved such creation, once or thrice in book after book, however, is not the point. Just as nature is not interested in perfection of a style, so the poetry of phenomena begins in the latest present. Oppen writes somewhere in his daybooks that Robert Creeley was ultimately a mannerist, which isn't true, though I understand that, to a mind as absolute as Oppen's, any poem whose first surface calls attention to its construction is ultimately trivial given the reality of the derogated earth and its inhabitants. Creeley's poems are intimate. He speaks often of the company, and he spent his life making that company in poetry. Near the end of Creeley's life, I was lucky for a time to join it, to be in his company. I believe his work is absolutely objective, but not in the sense that Oppen takes the word, as Creeley's work is always aware of the syllable, the line, the living through the language. In that sense, Creeley's poetics are materialistic, a value system that offended Oppen. Still, in Oppen, who I never knew, whose poetic scale always engaged the politics of being in relation, not in the company of, I find a refusal of company that instructs me. I can be stopped. Again, anytime. By shame. The man sitting on his stoop. In a world of stoops defeated. What can anything I have written mean to him? He does not know how he can live his life. I can tell him nothing. Unless perhaps he can think of his grandchildren. As if they were in some way himself. And I know of no reason he should do so. This is a good poem because it survives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.